How will SpaceX fuel a Starship and Super Heavy before an orbital flight? What will enable SpaceX to increase precision for a booster catch attempt? And what will power Starship flights towards Mars? Let's find out.
What about it? Go for launch.
We're go for launch. Let's light this candle.
Ignition sequence start.
My name is Felix and I am your host for today's episode of What About It? And as always, there's been a lot going on in the space industry lately, so let's dive right in.
Starship updates.
And we're back with another information-packed update on SpaceX's Starship and Super Heavy progress made in Boca Chica, Texas. SpaceX is preparing for orbital Starship launches, and to accomplish the task, they need to have a lot of good ideas in place. We're back in RGV Aerial Photography's plane once more. Mauricio was on site again, taking some of the most interesting pictures to date of what SpaceX is working on at the Starbase. What you're looking at here is the launch site. This is where SpaceX is preparing for the first launch to take a Starship into orbit above Earth. And SpaceX is speeding up the progress more and more. Here's what's happening right now. Do you see those two new foundations? Those weren't here 2 weeks ago. SpaceX is building more and more infrastructure to launch the biggest rocket into orbit to ever take flight. And to be able to reach this goal before the end of the summer, they are working 24/7. Those two new foundations will likely become the staging area for Starships. This is where SpaceX will stack Starships on top of Super Heavy boosters, do checkouts, and prepare the rockets to be lifted onto the orbital launch mount. You can already see the circular base rings inside the rebar mesh. Those will hold the weight of the rocket stages. Jumping to the construction site for a second, this element is being built right now next to serial number 2.1, which has recently been rolled back from the launch site after completing its test run to determine if the Super Heavy thrust pack construction can take the load. It's unknown right now as to what it's for, but I am pretty sure that this is for one of the new foundations next to the orbital launch mount and the support tower. Why? Looking at one of those elements up close reveals the immense size and also one other interesting aspect. Do you see those pins sticking out on one side? Those are concrete anchors. The element is placed in position and concrete is poured over the anchors to connect the metal piece to a concrete element. Looking at RGV's pictures again shows that these anchors are on the inside of the ring currently being built. So this element, whatever exactly it is, will be placed around a concrete foundation, which rules out any use at the orbital launch mount or the tower. Everything seems to happen at the same time right now. While the staging area has begun construction, SpaceX is also working on the orbital launch mount, the support tower, the fuel farm. They've gone to plaid. The orbital launch mount recently received the predicted intersections between the pillars. These are needed to spread the load even further and to fix the orbital launch mount pillars in place. This should be the last step before SpaceX starts stacking the orbital launch table on top of it. Depending on what will actually be needed for this first launch, SpaceX very much seems to be on track for a first orbital launch before the end of the summer. And plaid really does seem to fit here. While building the staging area and the orbital launch mount, the SpaceX work crew is also stacking the tower further and further. Segment number 6 has recently gone up. Two more to go. Then a crown block to be able to utilize the drawworks at the base of the tower for stacking and lots of plumbing, electrics and sensors to flesh it out. Never in the history of spaceflight has such a large tower been built in such a short time. Just below all that, the orbital fuel farm is looking more and more complete. 5 of the tanks are still missing and currently being built at the construction site further up the road. There are 2 gray tanks visible here. The one in the foreground is a large water tank, possibly for the deluge system at the launch mount. The other one is a so-called cryo jacket, technically a tank on top of a tank. This one is still empty, but at some point a silver ground support equipment tank will be under it. The cryo jacket will be filled with nitrogen and all this will insulate the GSE tank on the inside, preventing ice buildup and keep the liquid fuel and oxidizer cool for a long time. Zooming in a bit, we can also see that the plumbing surrounding the tanks is already being covered up with concrete plates. Progress is very fast here. Jumping to the suborbital pads, famous for all those high-altitude Starship test flights we witnessed earlier this year, reveals what I already predicted on the last episode. They are being repurposed and outfitted to play at least a small role in the next chapter of Starship development – Phase 3 or orbital flights. Pad B has been turned into a parking lot for now, leaving it without any current activity. Pad A, though, is a whole different story. It's right now being repurposed to be able to test the Beast. This is where the first Super Heavy booster currently being built at the construction site will let loose its Raptors for the first time. Musk has confirmed it on Twitter after I suspected it on the last episode. The first prototype booster is almost done. It will be used to test out plumbing, engine configuration, the thrust pack, and everything else needed for a good flight, and it will do so at Pad A. If you look closer, you can see an extra element that has been stacked onto the pad. It's an adapter to make the booster fit and stand tall enough for the Raptor engines not to completely destroy the pad below on these upcoming short static fire ignitions. Lots of extra plumbing is laying around as well. The modifications are extensive to make it suitable for a Super Heavy booster test campaign. Moving into the middle of the launch site, the yellow pipe dream continues. The shape of construction becomes more and more visible. It's large and pointy and yellow. More and more theories are emerging as to what this might be. Mauricio from RGB Aerial Photography tweeted that it might be the fueling arm that will carry the propellant piping for the Starship's second stage after being stacked on top of a booster. It would swing to the right after fueling is complete. This is not official, of course, and might also be a temporary solution if it is true. Starships refuel from the bottom. The reason for this is simple. The best part is no part. Musk and his team at SpaceX plan to make Starships in orbit refueling capable. Two Starships will dock together on the engine section and one transfers its fuel towards the other using thrust impulses. This is necessary if a Starship is supposed to make its trip to Mars and land there. So the Starship already has to have a fueling adapter on the bottom. SpaceX's plan up until now was to also utilize this adapter on Earth. Fuel for Starships comes in at the bottom. Alex Swan has put out some awesome animations recently. One of them shows the Starship on the pad while being fueled for the launch. Until now, the general idea has been that the booster connects to the same fuel adapters as well. So the booster is being fueled and then just passes more fuel and oxidizer up through the fuel adapters on the engine section of the Starship. More complex fuel adapters would not be needed this way, reducing complexity and weight, resulting in a cheaper rocket with lower maintenance. Once fueled, the Starship is released with a less complex mechanism, as there would be no need for a large orange arm and a bigger fueling adapter that can receive fuel from the bottom and the side on the upper stage Starship. If this system is not reliable enough, or if the fuel line going up inside the Super Heavy booster would be too heavy, it might make sense after all. In flight, this fuel line going up inside the booster would not be needed. The construction would lose weight and complexity by leaving it out of the structure. The real question here would just be what saves more weight and complexity. Using a fuel line that goes up inside or outside the Super Heavy booster to fuel the Starship, or utilizing a slightly bigger fuel adapter on the Starship, which can receive fuel from the bottom and the side and saving weight on the booster. What do you think? Would a Starship make more sense if it receives fuel through the booster or on its own on the launch mount? Make sure to tell me in the comments, I am eager to read your opinions. Interesting developments, I'll definitely keep you in the loop on this one. Next up, we're going to take a close-up look at the first flight-ready vacuum Raptor engine and some smaller thrusters that might be essential for catching a booster. Stay tuned. The Y family needs your support. Give the video a like, subscribe, and share it with your friends on Twitter or Facebook to show the YouTube algorithm that you appreciate the content. Looking for a more direct way of support? Become a Patreon or YouTube member by clicking the join button right under the video and get some awesome perks. Gain access to our Discord server where you can meet me and the rest of the community or get a completely ad-free release of each and every episode provided just for channel members. Or do you know about the Y Warehouse? Shop for your next Starship shirt, hoodie or cap and look as awesome as you feel. Links can be found in the description. You rock! So we've had the progress at the orbital launch site, which on its own would be impressive enough. But that's not all. We're talking SpaceX. What you're looking at here is one of the most incredible pictures taken recently by NASA spaceflight. It shows a Raptor engine, and those that know what a Raptor typically looks like will notice a big difference immediately. Its nozzle is much larger than that of a standard Raptor engine. It's of course a vacuum Raptor engine, or short RVAC. Three of these are used on an orbital Starship so that it can travel at optimal efficiency in space, and its arrival signals once again that we're not far from that first orbital launch anymore. It's just incredible to see all this happen in Boca Chica. Imagine a Starship powered by three of these doing an orbital insertion burn in the not too distant future. Musk has already confirmed on Twitter that this engine indeed is for Starship serial number 20 and for that first orbital flight. He also said that SpaceX is currently at 378 seconds of specific impulse and targets over 380 seconds specific impulse down the road. Those are some awe-inspiring numbers and, in a nutshell, mean that this engine is very efficient. These will carry our first Martian colonists to their new destination in the future. But it's not the only new engine that has been spotted on site. This is another one of NASA Spaceflight's awesome videos. It shows a thruster mounted to the top segment of a Super Heavy booster. Thrusters in such a position are often related to the so-called RCS, or Reaction Control System. This is a Le Padre recording from December of last year. It shows Starship serial number 9 before its flight, and it shows SpaceX testing the RCS before the launch. Currently, the thrusters used to correct the flight path of a Starship are traditional cold gas thrusters. Nitrogen is used in these thrusters to enable a Starship to turn in flight. That's not quite enough, though, for a rocket that size. And Musk has repeatedly stated that the current cold gas thrusters are just not powerful enough. An ISP of 60 against 300 on the hot gas version. And this is it, the first picture of those long-awaited SpaceX Starship hot gas thrusters. 5 times as strong as a cold gas system and able to turn such a giant rocket. SpaceX will likely not only use them for launches and orbital maneuvers, but also for landings. The positioning here on the top segment of a Super Heavy booster would enable it to control its descent even at low speeds when grid fins don't work anymore. Ova from SpaceX 3D creation Eccentric has made an excellent animation to show how it works. The current thruster design can fire into 3 directions. This way it can work together with the large grid fins and control its descent, maybe even more precise than a Falcon 9 booster, which still has problems with wind gusts. This way the weather window for a booster catch would be widened, and the precision of a booster coming down for a catch would be significantly increased. And what will this not be needed for? Exactly, the first Super Heavy and Starship orbital flight attempt. The booster will be landing in the water. There won't be a catch attempt on this first flight. Musk has already stated that this was a fit check. They will remove it again to speed up the time needed for preparations towards that first orbital launch. So, no hot gas thrusters on this first flight, but good news that SpaceX is already so far along in developing the thrusters needed for future flights. Here we are again, continuing our Skillshare class on how to become a successful content creator. We had Marques Brownlee and Andy Pizza already, both of which you can find classes from on Skillshare. And today, Helise, digital storyteller and YouTuber like me, will tell us about storytelling in less than a minute long videos. Whether it's a tutorial or how-to video, or you want to convey an emotion or express yourself, doing all this in a minute or less is an art on its own. Concepts like mood and theme, music and text, cinematography, framing and editing. Yep, I watched it too. All those can be learned on Skillshare in her inspiring class. You can even do amazing things with a smartphone and a mobile internet connection. It all depends on the proper knowledge, and that's where Skillshare really shines. Learn the art of short clip creation with Skillshare. The first 1,000 people to use the link in my description will get a free trial of Skillshare Premium membership, and after that, it's only around $10 a month. Today's supporter shoutout goes to Nidos, Mick Homer, Such Developments, Jimmy Long, Todd Brewer, Dory Onbe, Mark Perkins, and many others. You rock so much. Thank you very much for all your support, and make sure to hop on our supporter exclusive Discord to join more than 1,000 spaceflight enthusiasts and to give me a chance to thank you in person. Today's team shoutout goes to Diane for the second time. Working behind the scenes on our new website, together with many others, she's been pumping out designs and previews like crazy. The website is still a work in progress, but I can't wait to share more of this with all of you in the coming months. Diane, you rock! Jumping to the no. Or an orbital flight. Walt.
Okay, give me a second. Starship update.
Let's do that again. It's further up the road, I'm telling you. Everything seems to be very German today.
I bring you love.
Jumping to the suborbital. I can already see the freaking blooper. All right.